Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you, O God. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that you desire for us to develop our relationship with you. We thank you also that you are a God that desires his creation to come to him. So Lord, we lift up to you, Lord, our fasting week this week. We pray, Lord, that we will be expectant, we will be joyful, and even serious about it, so that you will speak clearly to us, so that you will guide us. And when prayers are answered, we will say it's because of you and it is for you. So Lord, we pray, Lord Father God, that you will bless us in this fasting week and you will be glorified, O God, in every aspect of it. Lord, we thank you, Lord Jesus, for our next gen children who are downstairs. We pray that you will bless them as well. We pray that even at their young age, they will know you personally. They will learn and grow, and you will prevent them from making mistakes, Lord Father God, because your word is guiding them. We thank you, Lord, for all the volunteers. Bless them, O God, right now. Empower them with your spirit. Give them wisdom, patience, and all the qualities they need to be able to minister to our children in the most effective way. We thank you, Lord Father God, for the finances of this church. We thank you, Lord, that you give us stewardship of these finances, which are all yours anyway. We pray, Lord Father God, that all of us will be cheerful givers, that you will be the one to provide for us, and we will also return to you what is dutifully yours, O God, and that we will be cheerful in doing that. We pray, Lord Father God, that there will always be wisdom and integrity in every aspect of how the finances are used. Lord, we come before you, O God, with expectant hearts. Lord, as we continue this series with Jesus Unboxed, we pray, Lord Father God, that you empower our brother Jojo right now. Speak to him mightily, speak through him, and empower him, O God. Override his preparation so that the only words that he will say is the ones that you would want us to hear, O God. And more importantly, O God, let our hearts be ready and our minds ready to hear what you have to say, to change what we need to change, and to do what you are telling us to do. And not doing it with delay, O God, but instead doing it immediately. So thank you, Lord Father God. Bless the rest of our service. We dedicate it all to you. For we pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. All right, so let's welcome Brother Jojo.
Thank you. Thank you, Pastor Ryan. Are you excited about that prayer and fasting week? I'm excited. No, I'm looking at the booklet earlier as Pastor Ryan was speaking about it, and I look at the devotions, and you can see if you have the booklet, it says pray for the nation, and then the next day pray for God's family, and then pray for family provisions, pray for family relationships, pray for the family's physical well-being, and pray for the family's spiritual well-being. And it's saying our theme for this year is pray for the family, emphasizing the need to lift up our earthly relationships to our Heavenly Father, bringing the realities of heaven into our homes and households. I remember when we were in Paihia, before the new year, together with some families, we were discussing before the new year hits, we were discussing what are the breakthroughs that we would want to see this year for each one of us. And maybe not surprisingly, most of those who were there, especially the fathers, we were talking about we want to see breakthroughs in our families, in our family devotions, in our family relationships, in the salvation of our family. And so seeing this, that the focus of our prayer and fasting week this year is also on the family, just really strengthens that need for all of us to focus on our family this year. And during our planning session with Pastor Ryan and the ministry coordinators yesterday, Pastor Ryan was also talking about the importance of intentional discipleship, that each one of us fathers will look after and disciple our own family. So hopefully we go with this, all of these themes coming together, we should focus on our families and family discipleship. So let's pray for that, no, that God will truly work in our families and strengthen our family relationships this year. So are you with us on that one? Amen, amen. Okay, so let's go to our topic. We have been going through the book of John, Jesus, and unboxing who Jesus is. Okay, so we are talking to, going to John chapter 8 today, and knowing more about who Jesus Christ is. And the topic for today would be, know the truth, be set free. Can you say that with me? Know the truth, be set free. And so, because we are talking about truth, get one half sheet of paper and answer these questions. No, I'm just kidding. Okay, so we'll just go through some true or false questions. And let's see how much knowledge we have on these things. First question, you can raise up your hand later on when I ask. First one, let's one by one. Lightning never strikes twice in the same place. Who says it's true? Oh, okay, so just process it. Who says it's false? Okay, so some said false. The answer is false. It's true pala, true. Okay, sorry, it's true. The answer is, false, sorry. I'm confused. It strikes twice in the same place. Okay, it strikes twice in the same place. The Empire State Building, it got hit already more than 100 times. So it's not true that it never strikes twice in the same place. This one, humans can distinguish between over a trillion different smells. True? Who says it's true? Who says it's false? Okay, so how many races do we have in the whole world? Around 200. Oh, can you smell each one of them? Okay, but it's true. We're not as good as the dogs. They smell more, but actually we can smell more than a trillion different smells. Imagine that. Okay, so when you go home, start smelling all those food in your house and see whether you can distinguish them. That's interesting. Adults have fewer bones than babies do. Who says it's true? I can see the nurses. Okay, so just say, go with the nurses on this one. Adults have fewer bones than babies do. Because when babies are born, I think the cranium, for instance, they are fragmented. So, and they get fused as we get to mature. So we have fewer bones than babies do. This one, you can try. Human can breathe and swallow at the same time. True or false? Who says it's true? Who says it's false? Okay, can you try it? Okay, we cannot breathe and swallow at the same time, right? So you try it at home later on. Why not right now? Okay, humans share, this is interesting. Humans share 50% of their DNA with bananas. Who says it's true? I can see the genius one. Okay, so we imagine that we share 50%. It's true. 50% of DNA, same with the bananas. Okay, so don't be offended if somebody says, you know what, you're like a banana. 50% true already. 50% true. Okay, so who says this true in for yourself? I have lost weight during the holiday season. Who says it's true? Wow, really? Some people. Who says it's false? Yeah, okay. So we will lose weight this coming fasting week. Okay, so there are some truths in the world that actually will not matter to our lives, right? Knowing that we share 50% of our DNA with bananas won't really matter for you, right? So it's not a matter of life or death. But there are truths that you need to know and that you need to respond to, because it will not impact only your life here on earth, but it will impact your eternity. And if there are truths that you would want to focus on, truths that you would want to know, and truths that you would want to really understand in your life, these are truths that impact your eternity. Where you will go after this life, how you will spend the rest of your eternity. Because what the life that we are spending here on earth is just a blip of the eternity that we will experience after this life. So if there is something that you will need to gamble on, if you are a gambler, okay, I know it's wrong to gamble, but if there is something that you will need to make sure of, is your eternity. So you need to know the truths that we will discuss this afternoon. Why is truth important? Okay, so I remember when my son had broken, I think it was, he had an injury in basketball. He broke his ankle, I think, somewhere down on his feet. And it got swollen. So for a couple of days, we thought it's just a simple sprain. But it got swollen, so we brought him to the hospital. And then the doctor had a look on the x-ray. And the doctor initially said, he has a broken bone on his ankle. And so we need to operate on him. Okay, so, wow, this is in the Philippines, okay? Unlike in New Zealand, when you go to the Philippines for operation, it feels like you get held up, right? So, because you need to pay a lot, unlike here where you go in and out without paying anything, right? So, we're worried about the money, we're worried about the health of my son, but it has to be done. Then we confined him in the hospital, and then they waited for it to subside, the swelling, before the operation. And so the operation day came in, and then he was dressed up for the operation, and he was brought to the operating room. Before he got operated on, they did another x-ray. Okay, and then after that x-ray, the doctor went out and said to me, and said to us, my wife and I, you know what, it will be a sin to operate on your son because it's not really a fracture that needs operation. We will just need to cast him. Okay, so they just put a cast on him, and he had the cast for around 2-3 months before they took it off. But after we got the bill, we thought, oh, it's a sin that you did not operate on him because it feels like the bill was for an operation and not for a casting. Okay, but anyway, what my point is this. Why is truth important? Because when you know the truth, you will know how to behave. Okay. Even so, when you know the truth, you will know how you will feel. You will also know how you will behave. If they had known if they had not known that he does not need to be operated on, then he will be operated on, and that's not necessary, right? So, very important for us to know the truth because right thinking leads to the right feeling, and right feeling will lead to right behavior. So it is very important for us to know first what are the truths, what are the facts, okay, what are the necessary information before we react and before we start to behave. So it's very important to know what the truths are. And so Jesus was talking about the truth that will set people free in John 8 verse 31 to 36. Can I ask everyone to please rise up and let's read these verses together with me? Okay, so 1, 2, 3. So Jesus was saying to those Jews who had believed him, if you continue in my word, then you are truly disciples of mine, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. They answered him, we are Abraham's descendants and have never yet been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free? They answered him, we are Abraham's descendants and have never yet been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free? The slaves does not remain in the house forever. The son does remain forever. So if the son makes you free, you will be free indeed. Let's just quickly pray. Lord, thank you so much for your word, Lord God. Thank you, Lord, that we can study it, Lord, in this place, O Lord God, freely, Father God. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that Lord, your word truly transform, O God. And we pray, Father, Lord, that as we listen to it, Lord Jesus, that our eyes will be opened, our hearts, Lord God, will be ready for your spirit to talk to us, O Lord Jesus, and confirm the words, O God, that we are sharing, Lord God, this afternoon, O Lord Jesus. Father God, just continue to work in us. Work through me, Lord God. Override my preparation and speak to your people, O Lord God, that, Lord, we will not just hear it, Lord, for knowledge's sake, Lord God, but for the transformation of our lives for the glory of you, O Lord Jesus. Thank you so much, O God. We ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay, so what's the topic today? Know the truth, be set free. So Jesus was talking, and in John chapter 8, verse 31, he was saying to those who had believed him, if you continue in my word, then you are truly disciples of mine, and you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. So three questions that we will answer during this message is that Jesus was talking about a truth that can make us free, that can make the Jews who he was talking to free. Okay, so what? Three questions. What is this truth that he is talking about? Second one, why is this truth connected to freedom? And the last one, what makes truth and freedom go together? Let's talk about truth first. Okay, so what is truth? In the Hebrew word, it's the Hebrew word for truth that is used in this verse is emet, or emet, A-E-M-E-T, emet, completely trustworthy, completely reliable. So truth is completely trustworthy. It is completely reliable. It is used over 200 times in the Bible, this word. In the Greek language, in the New Testament, the word used for truth is aletheia, aletheia, which is 100% accurate. So if something is 99% accurate, is it true? No. If 1% of it is false, it is still false, right? Truth is 100% true. So let's talk about the truth about truth. What are the characteristics of truth? Truth is factual. We need to know that there should be facts supporting the truth. When we say Jesus came here and was born in Bethlehem, and when you investigate, there is no such place as Bethlehem, is that truth? No. But praise God, Jesus came here, right? There is a place called Bethlehem, amen? And Jesus, there are accounts of Jesus in the historical books, and there are people who are non-Christians who attest that there is a Jesus who lived 2,000 years ago. So praise God, Jesus indeed lived here, and Jesus resurrected. And that is truth. Truth is factual. Second one, truth must correspond to reality. If I say my Bible is here in the podium and you don't see a podium, then it does not correspond to reality. But because you can see the Bible in the podium, then this must be true, right? If I say my wife is beautiful, is that true or no? Okay, thank you. Okay, so thank you very much. That corresponds to reality. Okay, so the third one, truth is not invented. Okay, some people invent truths, right? Do you know people who invent truths? Yeah, I have a neighbor back in the Philippines who can invent truth and really invent a web of lies to the point that it becomes true, that you don't know what the truth is anymore, right? So some people can invent truth, but truth is not invented. It is actually discovered, like law of gravity. Nobody invented the law of gravity, but you know it exists. You know it is true. Right? So truth is never invented. Truth is also not by majority decision. Okay? Just because everyone believes it is true already. Okay? So more and more we are seeing a lot more countries believing that men can marry men. Right? Is it that true? Is that correct? Just because more and more people, majority, are saying it is true, that it is correct, it is already true. Also, not because everyone, just because some people, only some people say it's true, it's false already. Okay? Even just a few people say it's true, if it is true, it is true. Okay? It's not by majority decision. Truth is timeless, universal. Whatever is true 4,000 years ago, whatever is true 2,000 years ago when Jesus said it, is still true today. Okay? It is not something that will change across time. And it is not affected by culture. Like, so for example, if you go to a place where you can eat people, is it true that you can really eat people? No? Right? So it is not affected by culture. So truth is timeless, it is universal, and this is true also. Truth can be painful. Have you experienced that? Yes, when somebody says to you, I don't love you, it is painful, but it could be true, right? So but a lot of people doesn't want to face the truth because it can be painful to them, right? Whenever I look in the mirror, I look quickly before I see my nose, because it is painful. So truth can be painful, but you have to face it, right? So, but sometimes it happens, right? So truth lastly, truth is narrow and exclusive. You can never say this one is true and this one is, for example, 4 times 4, for those who are good in math, equals 16, not 17, not 16.5, right? 4 times 4 is 16. It's exclusive. It cannot be 4 times 4 equals 16.5. It's 16. Truth is narrow and exclusive. And it's very important when we talk about the truths that Jesus claimed about himself. But in our lives now, in our culture now, more and more people are saying there is no absolute truth. Right? They're saying it depends on how you feel. It depends on your view. No? No one can say this is right or wrong. No one can always say this is the truth. This is the absolute truth. I'll show you a video and let's watch this and see how much of the young people now, this is in America, but I think it is also true here in New Zealand, more and more are accepting the fact that there is no absolute truth. Let's watch this video.
There's been a lot of talk about identity lately, but how far does it go? And is it possible to be wrong? We went to the University of Washington to find out.
Are you aware of the debate happening in Washington State around the ability to access bathrooms, locker rooms, spas based on gender identity and gender expression?
I think people should be able to have access to the facility.
I think bathrooms could and potentially should be gender neutral because there doesn't need to be a classification for differences.
I think people definitely should have the ability to go into whichever locker room they want.
I feel like at least public universities should do their best to accommodate for those who do not have a specific gender identity.
You know, whether you identify as male or female and whether your sex at birth is matching to that, you should be able to utilize the resources.
So if I told you that I was a woman, what would your response be?
Good for you. Okay. Like, yeah.
Nice to meet you.
I'd be like, what? Really?
I don't have a problem with it.
I'd ask you how you came to that conclusion.
If I told you that I was Chinese, what would your response be?
I mean, I might be a little surprised, but I'd say, good for you. Like, yeah, be who you are.
I would maybe think you had some Chinese ancestor.
I would ask you how you similarly came to that conclusion and why you came to that conclusion.
I would have a lot of questions just because on the outside, I would assume that you're a white man.
If I told you that I was 7 years old, what would your response be?
I wouldn't believe that immediately.
I probably wouldn't believe it, but I mean, it wouldn't really bother me that much to go out my way and tell you no, you're wrong. I'd just be like, oh, okay, he wants to say he's 7 years old.
If you feel seven at heart, then then so be it. Yeah, good for you.
So if I wanted to enroll in a first grade class, do you think I should be allowed to?
Probably not, I guess. I mean, unless you haven't completed first grade up to this point and for some reason need to do that now.
If that's where you feel like mentally you should be, then I feel like there are communities that would accept you for that.
I would say so long as you're not hindering society and you're not causing harm to other people, I feel like that should be a okay thing.
If I told you I'm 6'5", what would you say?
That I would question.
Why?
Because you're not. No, I don't think you're 6'5".
If you truly believed you're 6'5", I don't think it's harmful. I think it's fine if you believe that. It doesn't matter to me if you think you're taller than you are.
So you'd be willing to tell me I'm wrong?
I wouldn't tell you you're wrong.
No, but I say that I don't think that you are.
I feel like that's not my place as like another human to say someone is wrong or to draw lines or boundaries.
No, I mean, I wouldn't just go like, oh, you're wrong. Like, that's wrong to believe in it. Because, I mean, again, it doesn't really bother me what you want to think about your height or anything.
So I can be a Chinese woman.
You sure.
But I can't be a 6'5" Chinese woman.
Yes.
If you thoroughly debated me or explained why you felt that you were 6'5", I feel like I would be very open to saying that you are 6'5" or Chinese or a woman.
shouldn't be hard to tell a 5'9 white guy that he's not a 6'5 Chinese woman. But clearly it is. Why? What does that say about our culture? And what does that say about our ability to answer the questions that actually are difficult?
Like that, if you stand for nothing, you'll fall for anything, right? So because of the culture of acceptance that the world seems to have endeared into a lot of people, is that anything and everything can be explained and can be accepted. As long as you're happy, as long as I'm not bothered by what you believe in, then it's okay, right? But black is black, white is white. There are truths in the Word of God that we need to tell people, and they have to accept, otherwise their eternity is at stake. What are these truths? I like this quote from Soren Kierkegaard. There are two ways to be fooled. One is to believe what isn't true. The other is to refuse to believe what is true, right? Truth matters, especially with regards to our eternity. The first truth that I want to share to you today is that we are enslaved by sin. And Jesus, during his discussions in John chapter 8, was talking to the Jews about it. So Jesus was saying to those Jews who had believed him, as we have read earlier, if you continue in my word, then you are truly disciples of mine. And you will know the truth, and the truth will make you free. Do you know what? They did not believe this statement of Jesus. How did they reply? They answered him, "We are Abraham's descendants and have never yet been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free?" So they did not understand what Jesus was saying. Actually, they probably are in denial. Because if you look at the Bible, the Jews were actually enslaved by the Assyrians, by the Babylonians, by the Romans. And yet they were saying to Jesus, "Hey, you know what? We are free. We have not been enslaved by anyone." Even for the literal fact of what Jesus is saying, they are already in denial. Because the truth is, they have been enslaved already. So the worst thing probably that you could feel is that you are enslaved and you don't know it. Right? You feel that you are free, but actually you are enslaved. And Jesus was saying this to them in the next verse. He says, "Truly, truly, I say to you, everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin." Right? Before we accepted Jesus, before we knew Jesus as your Lord and Savior, it was so hard to say no to sin. And it is only because of the power of God in our lives that we can actually say no to sin and that we are free. But actually before, and even now, for some of our sins maybe, we are still slaves. If you look at what Jesus was saying in the verse, "Know the truth and the truth will set you free." It is not a one-time action. Yes, you have been set free when you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Spiritually, you have been set free from the consequence of your sin forever. But we are work in progress. There are still sins that we cannot give up, right? There are still sins in our lives, and you know it, that you just keep going back to. But the Lord says, "Know the truth and you will be set free." That's why it's important. He says, "If you abide in my word, then you truly are disciples of mine. Know the truth and you will be set free." Because as you read the word of God, and I'm doing this for the past years of my life, past decades of my life, as you read it, every single time, if there is a sin that you are dealing with, there is a verse that God will talk to you and say, "You know what? This is the truth about you, about what you're going through. You know what? I'm going to set you free today from that sin." Every day still, God is freeing up sins in our lives, freeing up us from slavery. So, but the enemy doesn't want us to know this, right? In Titus 3:3, it says, "For we also once were foolish ourselves," can you relate to this? "Disobedient, deceived, enslaved to various lusts and pleasures, spending our life in malice and envy, hateful, hating one another." So if you read the Word of God, you can see all these things that you are. Before maybe, still maybe, right? You can see these are the things that you are still enslaved to. But the enemy doesn't want you to know this. In John chapter 8, verse 44, it says, "You are of your father the devil, and you want to do the desires of your father. He was a murderer from the beginning and does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. Whenever he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own nature, for he is a liar and the father of lies." Right? So, if you are a liar, who is your father? We are free already. Amen? Okay, so, but if you're still lying, right? You're still following the enemy. He's the father of lies. Right? So, he would want to us to listen to his lies. And there are a lot of lies that he is putting in this world. Example of these lies. You can relate on with this. Examples of lies that he is putting in our minds. Everybody's doing it, so it must be okay. Right? So everybody's just living in. Everybody is just smoking, drinking, having a good time, not worrying about having a relationship with God, not worrying about our eternity. Everybody's doing it. That's fine. Right? That's a lie of the enemy. The other one, safe sex. Right? So this is going through a whole lot in the world, even in the Philippines, because of this BPO contact center phenomenon, more and more people are getting AIDS. Because a lot of people, the enemy is also planting that safe sex thinking into a lot of our youth. Believe you me, there's no such thing as safe sex. Right? A lot of people think our kids are planned in terms of the number of years. But no one among my kids were planned at all. I love my kids, but they were not planned. So, because I thought safe sex, etc. But no, really. And the safe sex for all those kids and all those singles still, the safest sex you can have is within the confines of marriage. That is what God allows. Anything outside of that, it will only give you heartaches. But the enemy is putting this in the minds of the young people today. Another one. Do whatever you are happy with. YOLO. Who knows YOLO? Raise your hands. The young ones. Okay. So for us, yeah, Pastor Ryan knows this. Okay, so YOLO is? Yeah, good ones, young kids. You only live once. Okay, you only live once. So you learn something new today. Okay, so you only do whatever makes you happy. It's okay, right? So you'll die anyway. So do whatever you want. Go wherever you want to go. Okay, break relationships if you want. You only live once. And after that, you live eternity in hell. That's the next point about it. But the enemy is trying to put that in mind. You only live once. Do whatever makes you happy. Another one. More money will make you happy. This is very subtle, right? This is about contentment in life. If you are not contented, more and more you will be working hard, just looking after, making sure that you have more money because it will make you happy. And that's another lie of the enemy. Another one is follow your heart. Right? Follow your heart as long as you're happy. Whatever your heart wants, just follow it, right? Who knows Brad and Angelina? Right? So Brad and Angelina lived in for 10 years following their heart. And then when they decided, yes, we need to get married, so they got married. And then after 2 years, they separated, they divorced, right? So I just Angelina texted me about it. So, but after that, they divorce. So follow your heart. That's the way of the world, right? Just follow your heart, whatever makes you happy. Another one, God does not love you. Another lie of the enemy. God does not love you. Doesn't care for you. He only cares about himself. This is exactly what the serpent said to Eve, right? God doesn't care really about you. He doesn't want you to eat that fruit because you will be like him. He does not love you. But that is a lie of the enemy. Because indeed, God loves us so much that he sent his son for us to sacrifice his life for us so we can have salvation. And because of all these lies, we get into bondages. Because of the lies of the enemy, we get into slavery of sin. What are these bandages? Some of us might still be here. Some of us might have gone past through this, but these are the bandages that we go past through because we believe on these lies. First is alcohol and drugs. Right? Because you only live once, because everyone is doing it, I can go into alcohol and drugs. And this is very difficult to get out of if you are addicted to drugs and to alcohol. Another one, pornography and sex, especially with the advent of technology. You don't know what your kids are looking at. You don't even know what your fathers are looking at or your mothers are reading. Right? Pornography and sex is so prevalent in this world that it becomes a bandage to a lot of people, even to Christians. Another one, computer games. Okay. A study, and you could look this up, an article in the New York Post in August 2016 says that computer games are almost as addicting as heroin, even worse. Right? So it could really damage your brain. So a lot of kids now, and a lot of parents will relate to this. Now you can take your kids out of computer games, right? Or maybe the fathers are addicted. Huh? So especially those millennials, those young fathers, they're more addicted to computer games than their sons, right? So computer games are also a bandage. Another one, social media. Okay, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat, right? How many hours do you spend on these things? And it becomes a bandage. It's a bandage, you know, because when you wake up, what's the first thing that you look at? Your cell phone. Who posted something? Who texted me? And then throughout your whole day while at your work, looking at your phone. How, if you count the number of hours that you're looking at social media, you will know you are addicted. Another one, relationships. Some people are addicted and so dependent on relationships that it becomes a bandage to them. Here are some more sophisticated. Maybe you say, oh, I'm not addicted to any of those. But these are some more sophisticated bandages. Number one, materialism. Ladies, in your language, this is shopping. So, right? But a lot of us too, no? Even men are guilty of this, right? What's Samsung Galaxy now? S8? S8. Who has S8? Probably the one, or S7. The one who bought S7 also has S6, right? But bought S7 and disposed of the S6. iPhone 7. Okay, so you bought iPhone 7 even if you have iPhone 6, right? So you bought the curve even if the LED is working fine. So, okay, so materialism. More and more we are looking at how are we in terms of the other person beside you in the office or in terms of your neighbor. What is he keeping up with the Joneses, they say? What is it that they have that I don't have? Right? Materialism, bitterness, also a bandage. Anger, pride is a bandage. Right? More and more we see people worry. Okay, is a bandage. There is this person who is such a warrior that when his friends see him, they know he's always worrying. And then one day, they saw him that he was whistling. I don't know how to whistle, but he's whistling. Right? So, and then they knew, oh, something's up with this guy. You're not worrying anymore? Yeah. So, and they said, why? Why are you not worrying? Hey, I paid a man to worry for me. Wow, that's good. Really? Wow, really? How much are you paying him? $2,000 a week. Wow, can you afford it? No, but it's his worry, not mine. So, okay, so a lot of people worry. Do you worry? I worry about tomorrow, right? So, but Jesus is saying, do not worry. This is a bandage, right? This is a bandage. And these are bandages that Jesus would want us to be set free. And that we can be enslaved with these bandages. The story of this, the elephant, when they trained the elephant, is that when they were still younger, still a baby, they will tie them up to a chain and tied to a wood in the ground. Okay? So, and then because it's still a baby, it cannot get out. It cannot take out the wood. Okay, so they trained him that way, brainwashed the baby elephant to thinking it cannot get away. It cannot get away while it's still young. But at it matures up to 2,000, 5,000 pounds, big elephants, it still will not get out of the chain. Why? Because the mind of the elephant is brainwashed to the point that I'm tied up to this, I cannot get away from it. And sometimes that is us. I'm so tied up to my bondage. I'm so tied up to pornography. I'm so tied up to my bitterness. I'm so tied up to my pride. I'm so tied up to my worry that I know I cannot get out of it. But you know what? We have a good news today because Jesus can set us free. Amen? Jesus can set you free. That's the second point. Okay, the second truth that we need to learn, we can be set free. Although Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God." That is true. But because God loves us so much that He made a way for us to be set free. In John 8:31-32, it says, "You will know the truth and the truth will make you free." What is this freedom that God is talking about? This is not a freedom to attend church or not attend church. This is not a freedom to read the Bible or not read the Bible. It is not a freedom to choose the church that you're comfortable with. We are talking about the freedom to live the abundant and meaningful life that God has promised to us. This is the freedom that Jesus is talking about. If you know the truth, then you will have that freedom. So we will define true freedom as this. True freedom is the desire and ability to do God's will and to be all that God has designed you to be. Imagine that. That is the freedom that God is giving you. That whatever He has designed you to do, He will be able to do it in your life, to do His will. It is the desire and ability to do good and say no to sin. You can say yes to good deeds. You can say no to sinful things. That is the true freedom that God is offering to us. There is such a thing as a counterfeit freedom as well. Counterfeit freedom is thinking you can do whatever you like, you feel like doing without any consequences. No rules, no boundaries. The world thinks of freedom that way, right? No rules, no boundaries. But truly, true freedom is not that. The birds can fly. They have freedom to fly, but they should be in the air. Put them in the water. Can they fly there? They will die, right? The fish can swim with all the freedom in the sea, in the rivers, in the water. But put them in land. What will happen to them? They will die. And so, Jesus is saying to us, you can do my design for you. You can live the way I designed you to live with all the freedom that you can have. But there are boundaries. Because there are things that we will do that will not ensure our eternity and we will die a spiritual death. Right? So within that freedom, within that those boundaries, Jesus is offering true freedom. Freedom from what? The first one, freedom from guilt. Right? So you probably remember all your sins or most of your sins that you have done, especially the big sins that you have done since you were young. Right? You can remember all the lies, or maybe you have stolen from your parents, or maybe you have hurt someone's heart, or maybe you have said some bad things against some people. You remember them. You know what? But Jesus is saying this. If you know me, there is no more condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. In Romans 8:1. Therefore, there is now no condemnation from those who are in Christ Jesus. So, ladies and gentlemen, even if you still remember your sin, Jesus Christ is saying to you, you are free from guilt. And so, when we go to heaven, when He sees us, He'll look at the book and say, bam, not guilty. Not guilty of any of the sins that you have done. I am wiping them out as white as snow. I am taking them as far as the east is from the west. Jesus has forgotten and forgiven your sins, even if you have not forgotten them. There is no more condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. In 1 John 1:9, it says, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and righteous to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. So what is this saying? Just go to God. Ask for forgiveness. Let Him into your heart and say, Lord, I'm so sorry. I know I am a sinner. I know that I have not followed You. Forgive me. Every single time, as Christians, we also remember this. Be quick to repent, be quick to forgive. Make that your mantra. Be quick to repent, be quick to forgive. Say that with me. Quick to repent, quick to forgive. Right? So whenever you sin, go to God, Lord, please forgive me before your heart hardens. Right? If somebody sins against you, forgive immediately. That will make your Christian life so vibrant. Right? So always freedom from guilt. Another one, freedom from the spiritual consequence of sin. Right? So Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death. Whether you believe this or not, the truth is, if you don't have Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, the wages of the sins that you have done here is eternal separation from God. I cannot truly imagine that. When we have pain going through, we're undergoing pain in our lives. Sometimes you just hold on to the thought that this will pass, right? So whatever I'm going through, this will pass. I will just wait for it to pass. But imagine if you're in hell and eternal separation from God. You cannot say to yourself anymore, this too will pass. Because it will not. So while you have a chance to make sure that your eternity is in heaven, make sure that you do it. It could be now. And later on, we'll get that opportunity to accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior. Because it says, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. In Galatians 5:1, it says, it was for freedom that Christ set us free. Therefore, keep standing firm and do not be subject again to a yoke of slavery. So we are free. Say that with me. I am free. I am free. Say that again. I am free. Say that again. I am free. I am free with conviction. I am free. We are free because of the Lord Jesus Christ. Because of God, we are set free. And we have the freedom to live according to the truth. And this is what I'm so excited about. Right? Because when Jesus set us free, now we can live according to His truth. He says there, 2 Corinthians 3:16 to 18, whenever a person turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. Now the Lord is the Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. There is freedom. But we all with unveiled faces, beholding as in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are being transformed. We can live according to the truth. We can change from whoever we are now to someone who is like our Lord Jesus Christ. Imagine that, right? We are transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as from the Lord, the Spirit. And that is the promise of God. And the promise of God will happen if we just abide in His word. In Titus 2:11-12, it says, for the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all men, instructing us to deny ungodliness and worldly desires, and to live sensibly, righteously, and godly in the present age. So truth number one, we are enslaved by sin. But truth number two, we can be set free. How? Truth number three, Jesus is the truth who can set us free. And whether you believe it or not, that is the truth. And I encourage you, I submit to you, believe it for your eternity's sake. In John 8:36, it says, so if the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. If the Son makes you free, you will be free indeed. So whatever the bondage you're going through in your life, if you go to the Lord and say, Lord, please free me from this bondage. I don't want to be looking at the internet and looking at pornography again. I don't want to be going to my friends and drinking alcohol with them again and smoking drugs with them again. I don't want to see this person and feel bitter against this person again. Lord, set me free. And Jesus is the truth that can set you free. You just go to Him and He will make you free. In John 14:6, it says, Jesus said to them, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but through me. Truth is narrow and exclusive. We have learned earlier. Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father but through me. Some people will say to us, you know what? I can respect your religion. You respect mine. Okay? So we can coexist. But the truth is narrow and exclusive. If Jesus claimed that He is the way, the truth, and the life, and it's not true, that there is another way to heaven, then Jesus is a liar. And Jesus, if Jesus is a liar, who is His Father? The evil one. But that's not true. Jesus is true. Right? Jesus is the truth. He is the way, the truth, and the life. So there is only one way, and that is Jesus Christ. Right? It says in this word, in John 8:31-36, I'll just get back to this. It says there, so Jesus was saying to those Jews who had believed Him, if you continue in my word, then you are truly disciples of mine. Remember, Jesus said, I am the truth. I am the way, the truth, and the life. Let's change that word truth to Jesus. And He says, and you will know Jesus, you will know me, and I will set you free. So the truth that will set us free is Jesus Christ, our Lord. Believing in the Lord Jesus Christ for us to have eternal life. I would just like us to watch this. This is a video testimony of my daughter when she was 16 years old. It was presented in CCF Marikina. And just see how much change has been seen in her life. But she knew the truth back then. And it has really changed her and set her free. So let's watch this.
I am a blessed, talented, but unhappy 17-year-old girl. Yes, you heard it right. I was unhappy. I always see myself as an average girl. I sing, I dance, I act, and I have good grades. I live a normal life and feel fine most of the time, but there was always something missing. For many years, there was a space that nothing or no one was able to satisfy. I looked back and tried to trace when all these started. My childhood was the toughest phase of my life so far. I was fat. I still am. But it was the biggest struggle in my life when I was a kid. I felt extremely unwanted. And because of it, I became a terrible attention seeker. I wanted to be recognized, to be appreciated, and so I tried to win other people's approval by doing well in school. I was a consistent honor student until I transferred to a science high school and had a hard time maintaining my grades. But there was something new. A few guys started to show interest in me. I was shocked and skeptic at the same time. Being the poor young soul who longed for love and affection, these guys got me easy. Akala ko kapag nakahanap ako ng magmamahal sa akin, makukumpleto ako. But like they say, a right thing at the wrong time is still a wrong thing. It led to nothing but heartache. I realized that it is very wrong to enter a relationship at such a young age, especially that I am not yet ready and God has a lot to fix in me first. Now that I am in college, I face a different struggle. I am a student of UP Diliman, where I meet people of my age who are way better than I am in terms of academics. Now that I cannot please other people with my looks and in what I do best, what then is there left for me? I had lived a roller coaster Christian life. I grew up in a Christian family. I prayed to God often. I talked and talked, but rarely listened to Him. Even if I had been his child for many years, I get lost every once in a while. But the Lord is good. He never lets his children go. He said in his word in Luke 15 verse 4 that he will leave 99 sheep to look for the one who is missing. During the revolution camp last summer, God reminded me of all my insecurities and showed me that there was an empty space in my heart that only he can fill. His message is clear. Give up my insecurities, engage and commit my heart and my whole life to him so he can make me complete. It was the hardest thing to do because I've lived with this my whole life. God taught me that he let my relationships fail so that I would understand that the best relationship I could ever have is my relationship with him. He made me see that to stand out in a crowd doesn't mean that I outdo everyone else with my skills, but that he is known through others through me. My roller coaster Christian life is gone as I rely on God to direct my life. I began to appreciate and believe that I am special, not because of my talents or my grades. I'm special because God loves me and has a plan for my life. Each of us was made to glorify God's name and make him known to people with the kind of life that we live. My name is Joyce and I am a Jesus Zone.
That was 5 years ago, and I have seen how my daughter has really been transformed by God, because she has been set free, and now into a godly relationship with someone we're also proud of. And whatever your bandage is, whatever it is you're going through, whatever it is that you seem to not be able to get away from, there is only one answer. And that is Jesus and the relationship with Jesus Christ. John Piper said, "You are truly free when you have the desire, the ability, and the opportunity to do what will leave you with no regrets forever." So make sure that the freedom you're enjoying is a freedom that you won't have any regrets with. And that is the freedom that is being given by our Lord Jesus Christ. Let's all bow down our heads. If you are here this afternoon and you realize that your eternity is not assured, that you want this salvation that Jesus Christ is offering, this freedom that the Lord Jesus is talking about, you want the truth and the truth that is in Jesus Christ, and you want to have all your sins forgiven by him, his promise is that he will forgive you if you confess your sins to him and accept him as your Lord and Savior. And his promise is that you will have that eternal life if you allow him to be part of your life, if you accept him as your Lord and Savior. You just say this prayer from the sincerest depths of your heart. Just talk to the Lord and say this to him. Lord Jesus, I realize that I am a sinner. I realize that I need your forgiveness. Lord Jesus, I realize that I need your salvation, that I cannot assure my eternity with you if I don't accept you. Lord, could you forgive me as, Lord Jesus, forgive all my sins, everything that I have done from sins I remember, Lord, until now. Could you forgive me, Lord Jesus? And Father God, Jesus, just come into my heart. I accept you as my Lord and Savior. And I ask you to direct my paths from now on. Allow me to enjoy the freedom that comes from knowing you and having a relationship with you. Guide me by the hand and help me be more like you, Jesus, and be transformed like you, Jesus. I ask this in Jesus' name. And if you are here this afternoon, you know that you are still slave to some sins that you have not given up. You know that you are in a bondage. The Lord Jesus is saying, know the truth and you will be set free. Know the truth that you are in sin. Know the truth that you are not giving up your sin. Just go to the Lord and just surrender it all up to him. The power of sin is broken in your life when you have Jesus in you. And so you can have that victory that Jesus promises if you just allow him to help you. Father God, we come before you, Lord. We have these pet sins, oh Lord God, that we cannot just get away from. Father God, we just surrender them to you, Lord God. Lay them down upon your feet, oh Lord Jesus, and ask for your forgiveness, oh God, and ask for your strength, oh Lord. Ask for your power, oh Lord God, that we can overcome this, Lord God, and let have the victory in our lives, O Lord Jesus, and see our lives being transformed by you and by your word, O Lord Jesus. Help us, O Lord God, that when we come out of this place, O Lord Jesus, that we will have that strength, Lord God, from your spirit to just move forward, Lord God, and get over, O Lord God, all these bandages, O Lord God, that is enslaving us, O Lord God. Help us, O Lord Jesus. We want to have the victory in you, O Lord God. We want to have the victory that is in you, Jesus. Help us, O God. Help us, O Lord. Thank you so much, O God. We thank you for this day, O Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you are our truth. And because of you, we have the way to heaven, O God. We have the way to eternity. And that is you, Lord, the salvation that you are offering. Thank you so much for your love. We give you all the glory. We give you all the honor, O God. And all the free people who believe in God, say amen. Amen. Praise God.